I'm Richard Shinas, the Dean of the Dietrich College of Humanities and Social Sciences, and it's a great pleasure to welcome Javier Soltero as the inaugural speaker in the Dietrich College Entrepreneurs Speaker Series, a series co-organized by our college and the Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. In 1998, Javier graduated from CMU with a major in information systems and industrial management. And now, a brief 17 years later, he is the corporate vice president for Outlook Program Management and Cloud Services at Microsoft. No small journey. Even better, Javier is married to another DC alum, Emily Morris, who graduated from DC with a degree in technical writing in 1996. And even though they never actually met during their time here, I think it's safe to say that as the business people like to put it, value proposition of Javier's education at CMU was quite positive. So Javier has a wide range of fascinating experiences in the tech industry to relate. He's occupied important positions or been a founder at Netscape, Backflip, Covalent Technologies, Hyperic, SpringSource, VMware, Redpoint, Accompli, and now Microsoft. And I'm sure I missed a few, yeah? He has been centrally involved in a variety of open source communities, including projects like JBoss and Apache Tomcat, and was an active advisor for a number of open source and SaaS, software as a service, for those of you who don't know, startups. And in January of this year, Microsoft launched Outlook for iOS and Android, a rebranded version of Javier's startup Accompli's app, to replace the oft-derided Outlook web app, OWA, as the go-to mobile email client for Office 365 users. Javier is the guy for Outlook Mobile and now for all of Outlook. And after having lunch with him a few months ago and dinner with him last night, it's obvious that Javier is also extremely thoughtful, curious, and I sense happy to take this opportunity to reflect on his experiences, both here and in the tech world he has occupied for over 15 years. So in so many senses, it's a real treat to have him back at Carnegie Mellon. Please welcome Javier Soltero.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming and spending your lunch time here with me. Normally, I don't even need a mic, but I'll use one just because it's here. So where do I begin? When I was originally approached to come and talk here at my alma mater, a little bit about my experience and the overall journey of these 17 years, and yet you didn't miss one, you got all the companies right, I think, although most of them are not around anymore. I was struggling to figure out exactly what it is that I would say to all of you, students, faculty, friends, family, etc., about not just my journey, but in general, like, why would you even care, right? There's stories of people doing things in technology or in the business world all over the place, and I'm modest and grounded enough, I guess, to not think that my story is really that special. So I did a lot of sort of thinking about what is it that I could share that would be in any way useful to such a broad audience, and certainly to people that are, you know, here at Carnegie Mellon, a place where, as you'll learn in a minute, I had such an interesting adventure. So hopefully this talk will make that obvious. This is sort of the picture version of what Richard just mentioned, right? All these different companies, and one of the things that I've realized, particularly in the last 3 or 4 years of my career, is I you know, you do a little self-examination, you look back and you say, wow, can I look at every single career decision or really life-changing decision that I made and feel like it's the right one? And certainly today, as a now 41-year-old professional, an executive at Microsoft, and a person who's been blessed with a great family and all these other things, you could look back on this picture and say, wow, look at this guy, right? He was born in Puerto Rico, a lot of stuff happened, and now he's at Microsoft, and it seems like it was all part of some kind of super calculated, very deliberate set of moves that I was constantly sort of fine-tuning. In fact, we just had this conversation earlier this morning with a group of students who asked, well, what do you do when you get to these points as forks in the road, whether you're at a company or you're in your sort of early stages of your career, how do you make sure that you're making the right decision? And I guess the honest to God truth is, at any point in these various steps, it's fair to say that I didn't know that I was making the right decision, and that only in aggregate and really in retrospect does it all make sense and seem like it was all part of a well-executed plan. So the story begins here, right? I grew up on an island that's 100 miles by 35. It's a very small place, beautiful place, filled with over 3.5 million people, and was fortunate enough to grow up in a family filled with entrepreneurs. My family's business is the sale and distribution of equipment related to servicing automobiles. And my grandfather was astute enough to build out this company along with the help of my dad and some of my uncles in the 50s or early 60s. In part by exploiting the sort of unique situation that we were in as a Spanish-speaking country that's part of the United States, to be able to broker distribution relationships and sales relationships with other countries in Latin America who also needed equipment that was made and still is made by all these American companies, but who didn't know really how to transact and do business in Latin America, where the relationship you have with people that you're selling stuff to is so much more important. So from a very early age, I got the opportunity to see sort of what an entrepreneurial journey is and what a family business journey is. I also got this other very sort of unexpected and interesting benefit. The business that my family was in and still is in, and that paid for my attendance at this fine institution, was kind of built upon the inherent instability of automobiles. The fact that cars break because they're such complex machines means that there has to be equipment to service cars. And that selling equipment to service cars turns out to be a pretty good business, certainly enough to have afforded me the opportunity to go to this great but very expensive school. And it was that sort of quality about that space that I would have never really, it took, you know, 15, 20 years later that I realized that I would later go on to build out a company, my first company, that was actually powered by the same fuel in a sense. But before I get to that, I guess aside from beautiful beaches and awesome weather and things that are probably very familiar to everybody who spent at least some time here in the great city of Pittsburgh, I was fortunate to grow up in this place, but not fortunate enough to learn the importance of having to work very hard for things, particularly in school. So I got through high school. I did pretty well. I'm convinced that I would not be accepted into Carnegie Mellon today. That seems to be a common refrain, certainly amongst faculty members that I've raised this issue with. No one would be accepted to Carnegie Mellon except for hopefully all of you. So congrats on that. I leave Puerto Rico and go from this to that. You have to imagine the task of going to Google Images and looking for a picture of Carnegie Mellon's campus that doesn't include some amount of this fine white powder that I believe you all refer to as snow. It's not that hard, actually. You go to Google Images, look for a Carnegie Mellon campus picture, and chances are pretty good that it's going to have some snow in it. This turns out to be just a very good bird's eye view of at least, now that's a dated picture. Actually, there's a lot of stuff missing. 1992, I start my career here, originally in a very different discipline. I had the mistaken assumption that I was bound to be a scientist, that I was fascinated by genetics and biology, and I had this sort of, I want to be a genetic engineer. Little did I know, like, I don't even know what that is, really, but I'd seen Jurassic Park, and it sounded like a good idea. And I show up here in this extraordinarily competitive place, and perhaps unlike any other speaker that you may hear, I basically squandered my first year here and was very politely asked by the school to not come back, at least to take some time off and reflect on the lack of commitment and, you know, sort of work ethic and who knows what else. But basically, I showed up here. I was studying the wrong thing, and I also wasn't really tuned into how hard you have to work in order to even tread water here. That was so overwhelming. This place is so unbelievably challenging in every discipline that even back then, when you first started here as a freshman, we heard the president of the school at the time tell all the parents and all the incoming freshmen that out of every 10 of you, only 7 will graduate, and only 4 of you will graduate on time. And that was some pretty awesome stuff for parents to hear, really, at the beginning on orientation week. So I totally had my head up my ass for the entire first year of my time here. The school says, hey, you really need to reassess your priorities and get your act together. We recommend that you take a year off. I actually didn't take a year off because I'm just really stubborn that way. I went off and I tried to start again. At another school, I went to Purdue University, figuring, okay, maybe Carnegie Mellon wasn't the right place for me. I'm going to go to Purdue and start again as a freshman, and let's sort of do a do-over on freshman year. It turns out that being the unbelievably stubborn guy that I am, I didn't really learn my lesson there either, and so there, too, I was asked to perhaps reconsider my academic priorities and my goals in life and all this. And so I returned to Puerto Rico, head firmly tucked between my tail, or whatever the expression is. And it was during that time that I finally internalized, I guess, what I had not done right in those first 2 years of my university career. And it really boiled down to motivation, right? Like, my initial motivation coming here, and the motivation of a lot of people, arguably including my wife, who also graduated here, and I'm proud to say she graduated on time. We started freshman year 1992, and she was out of here in 1996. I, on the other hand, took a little bit longer. Technically, while you may say that it's 98, I prefer to say it's December of 97. It's a little bit of a semantics thing, but, you know. So, the motivation that I originally thought I had when I got here was the fear of failure, right? The fear of disappointing my parents and all the people who were like, wow, he's going to Carnegie Mellon, big deal, awesome, great. And the reality is that fear of failure is a terrible motivator for me. It may be for some people. Certainly most people go through this, you know, their 4 years of school here and never even consider failure as an option, right? Like the idea that you would fail out of Carnegie Mellon after making such a big investment and having to fight so hard to even get in here seems preposterous. Certainly for me, now 41 years old and much later in life, it's very odd for me to walk around these halls and see myself as, you know, a freshman, you know, just, it's a very complex set of emotions. But in the end, it wasn't fear of failure. It was something related but different, which was the desire to win and the desire to be successful was a better motivator for me. And they're obviously very, very closely related. But it took failing out of two institutions and having to spend some time in what I call a semester abroad, really, in Puerto Rico, getting my act together. And it was during that time that after really figuring out that what I had wanted and really wasted was to get a degree from here, and that I had tuned into the fact that I liked technology and computers, which I had liked since I was 9 years old, and it was sort of baffling that I would have come here and not really tuned into that, considering that's in many ways what we're about. That on sometime in the late summer of 1994, I decide to write a letter to Michael Murphy, then Dean of Students, saying, hey, hi, I'm Javier. It was a letter, like an actual printed letter, which, who does that? And I told him the story. And I said, hey, I missed out on this opportunity. I figured out, after much exploration, that what I really wanted was a degree from Carnegie Mellon. And I had, frankly, I guess, the guts to ask for the order. I said, I'd love to come back. And to my great surprise, and frankly, my parents were absolutely blown away by this, a few weeks later, I get a letter in the mail saying, we'll see you in January. And so at that point, things kind of finally got back on the rails, and I was happy to say I came back here, I had my priorities straight, and I had a wonderful time sort of completing what turned out to be some amazing coursework and the opportunity to work alongside not only brilliant faculty members, but amazing students. Tail end of that, everything looks great. I have the blessing of graduating at a time when there was just all this appetite to hire Carnegie Mellon people, just like there is today. And despite having all the plans in the world to go work on Wall Street, out of pure chance, and this is kind of a recurring theme here, decide to take the opportunity, really a free trip to California was how it was sold to me, to go interview at this place called Netscape. And once I show up at Netscape, I end up falling in love with this company that was at the dawn of the internet era. And literally, in what can only count as the most amazing coincidence of all coincidences, on the same day that I have my interview at Netscape, where I ultimately took a job, I go out that night in San Francisco and end up meeting up with a bunch of people from Carnegie Mellon. Among them was this woman who also went to Carnegie Mellon, and I sort of recognized in that, yeah, I've seen her around campus kind of way. And then she also worked at Netscape, which was even weirder. And that woman is now my wife and the mother of my two kids. And that was 17 or 18 years ago, this coming November 7th. So in a single day, my entire life and my supposedly well-thought-out plan of attack, which had me going to Wall Street and working in what would have been a terrible, 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 terrible job for me, was kind of completely turned sideways, and I've been in California since then. And not only did I marry somebody who went to Carnegie Mellon, but it turns out her father, who is here in the audience as well, had also gone to Carnegie Mellon and received a master's degree from the Dietrich College in history. And so there's all these sort of weird connections, right? Amazing, seemingly serendipitous connections. And here I am at this job in California at the dawn of the internet era, working for the company that maybe most of you are not old enough to remember, maybe some of you are, but really the company that started all this off. And the significance of this picture, which probably you have no idea what this is, so that little dragon guy, that's Mozilla, that is the mascot of Netscape. Back in 1997 or 1998, when this picture was taken, Microsoft and Netscape were engaged in a very, very bitter war, a war that led to Microsoft, my current employer, for whom I am endlessly grateful, and just, yes. It took them all the way to, you know, antitrust hearings and very significant changes, and it ultimately led to Netscape going out of business. But before all that happened, there was this very, very, very bitter rivalry between the Internet Explorer team, which was the browser team at Microsoft, and the entire Netscape organization. Like, there was really one team that hated us at Microsoft, and yet the entire Netscape company just hated everything about Microsoft. And so one day, when IE3.0 shipped, the very clever people at Microsoft dropped that giant blue Internet Explorer logo on the front lawn of Netscape's campus as sort of a big sort of FU to the folks at Netscape. And of course, the Netscape people found out about it because unlike them, we worked very late at night. And the next morning when all the media trucks showed up, this is what they saw. So of course it was sort of turned into more of a monument of Mozilla really trouncing IE, which of course isn't what actually happened, but still it was a really fun thing. This picture captures so much of what was special about being at that company at that part of, you know, history, right? This was a job that people who worked there loved working there. It really, unlike the experience that I had as an intern on Wall Street, taught me the opportunity of, or taught me what it was really like to truly just love what you did for a living. The first meeting I had in my first project at Netscape, I was thrown into this room where people from Visa, Netscape, and then Anderson Consulting, now Accenture, were kicking off a project to figure out how to get people to be able to pay their bills online, something that we can now do from here, right? But this was back then, and so I remember being in that room thinking, I cannot believe this is my job. Like, I'm here sitting, figuring all these extraordinarily smart people, and we're going to figure out how to get people the ability to securely pay their utility bills online. And that was the beginning of lots and lots of amazing parts of that adventure. Ultimately, after spending some great time there, Netscape gets dealt sort of a mortal blow by Microsoft, and AOL, the McDonald's of the internet, comes in and swoops up and buys us for all the wrong reasons. So they buy Netscape for our homepage. And we're like, really, the homepage? But we have all this cool software and all this other stuff, and no, they wanted something called NetCenter. And that was the beginning of the end for Netscape, culturally and organizationally. Then Sun got involved, and Sun was also just a terrible, terrible, terrible place. And just a lot of, you know, we went from being this very, the analogy is, we went from being this very, very good bistro to getting bought by McDonald's. And everything sort of went south after that. And so that led me and a bunch of other people to go off and join the ranks of then sort of dot-com era startups. And I left Netscape all sort of bitter and angry because this great place had been turned into something bad. And I'm like, I'm going to go to a startup, and I'm going to work really hard, and we're going to build something that everyone can use, and I go join this company, Backflip. And Backflip had its distinction, but because it was built by a bunch of ex-Netscape people, but also because it was one of the first companies who built this great mystique by not telling anyone what they were actually building. It was a stealth company, stealth internet company. And even as an interviewee, like as a person applying for a job there, you actually were not told what the product actually was until basically you were given the job offer, which is preposterous. And it's a little bit of career advice for anybody here. Don't fall for that. That is the absolute biggest bunch of horseshit ever. Like, you need to know what the company is building, because what happened to me, at least, is by the time I was told, I was so competitively driven to want to work in this place that it masked the online bookmarking. Really? That's the whole thing? Is online, you're just a bookmarks in the browser, you put them online? This is the grand thing that you've been hiding from the world? Of course, my wife, the person who's made all the right calls on my behalf here, when I told her, she was my girlfriend at the time, but I told her, okay, so I'm not supposed to tell you, but what they're doing, it's like, it's online bookmarking. She's like, what? That's really stupid. And she was right. So after that fails, and really the lesson there for me was, it was awesome to work and be so motivated, even if it was the emptiness of you're working super hard, you're pursuing some kind of dream, you're surrounded, just like nowadays, with all these other startups and companies going public and people getting rich left and right, and oh my God, this is so incredible. And then of course it doesn't work, right? And not only does it not work, but things start turning south very quickly. And at that point, because I was I wasn't there doing a startup because that was the cool thing to do. I mean, I reckon myself a software engineer. This is my trade. This is what I do for a living. And I had every intention of staying in that business, even if at the time people were fleeing it in droves. And San Francisco and the Bay Area was kind of a ghost town. So I go and join this other company called Covalent. And the rationale there was, I went from like pursuing this crazy consumer internet dream back to plumbing. Covalent was a startup building internet infrastructure products around open source, something called the Apache web server, which isn't even that relevant anymore, but at the time was the biggest web server of all time, and it was built around this open source model and all these great things about it. And my logic in joining Covalent was, yes, I want to go back to working at a company that sells something that people pay money for. And I had been so terrified by the experience of building and managing a live website, a live web application, that I was like, no, what I want to do is I want to ship stuff on CDs. and get something on CD, have a customer pay money for that, and then they don't call me late at night to ask me to fix it. Like, we don't have to do these orchestrated updates to the service. It's just stuff on CDs. People buy it. It's boring enterprise software. Sign me up. And you go join this company, which was backed by some of the most prominent VCs still to this day, including Sequoia Capital, who had around the same time made an investment in a very small company called Google. And we spent a few years building, really just ignoring all the signals that were pointing towards the right business model, and instead basically stupidly following old rules for what was really a brand new game around how software, even enterprise software, was supposed to be built. Through that journey, I come up with the idea for building a new type of management product, and this is where the whole my parents sell stuff to fix cars thing comes into play. We saw this opportunity to build a new kind of software that would help people that built large-scale websites or large-scale distributed web applications manage and monitor their health and make sure that they could fix them when they broke down, because like all good complicated things, they broke down often, right? We built the product, built a team. The company spends about $15 million of the total 32 or so that they raised. And we managed to sell it to three customers, two of whom were on Wall Street. I was very, very involved in selling this product because I drew the short straw in the, Javier is the only person who can explain how this thing actually works and why you should buy it. And so I went on many ride-alongs with salespeople, all of whom got commission. And I guess I got the satisfaction of closing a couple deals there, but never got paid for it. And then the company goes out of business, slowly. Sequoia, the lead investor of the company, is about to take Google public. This is in 2004. And they're like, right, so Covalent is it? Great, listen, close it up, it's fine. No hard feelings, all good. We're good over here with the money. You guys need to wind this thing down and close it up and we're done. And as part of that winding down, we couldn't find a buyer for the company, and I don't remember who it was, came up with the idea to buy the product that we had built from Covalent's investors, who, much like a bank, really doesn't want to repossess your car because they don't know what to do with it. VCs don't want to take back any of the technology and other stuff that their company's built. They'd really prefer to just have things either get sold or shut down cleanly and sort of on to the next one. To go and basically make an offer to buy this technology for a dollar. So you buy this, you go to these extraordinarily experienced investors and you say, hey, you know that thing, that product that, as Doug Leone of Sequoia Capital described, was a product in search for a market? I heard that. I heard that our lead investor had described our project, my project, as something not worthwhile. And candidly, I was like, well, fuck that guy. Like, he doesn't know, right? This is a great product. And I guess in retrospect it was, but it was a very ballsy move that was driven mostly from a true sense of conviction about what we had built. And so me and five other guys go make this offer. We say, we're gonna take this thing off your hands. We're gonna give you a dollar for it in exchange for us taking on the liabilities from these three very large customers that we've sold, which included, among other people, Deutsche Bank and I think Morgan Stanley. So two giant Wall Street firms that had sunk hundreds of thousands of dollars into this product. And we orchestrated this move to have Covalent's investors declare it a huge victory. They're like, great news, Deutsche Bank. This product lives on, and it's going to be the focus of this new company, staffed by the same people that built it. I sort of conned them into saying it that way, because the ace was, you want to sell to Deutsche Bank again, Sequoia, right? You want to be able to have portfolio companies call on these same buyers again, so you cannot burn them. In exchange, I'm going to take this off your hands for a dollar and really have very limited understanding of the enormous risk we were taking at the time. So it was worth that much. And I still have the dollar that we offered but it was not accepted. Of all the legal documents I've ever signed in my life, the receipt or the asset purchase agreement that gave us the rights to this technology remains the most ironclad piece of paper I think I've ever signed in my entire life. It basically was like, this thing is not ours, is theirs. We have no continuing interest in any of this. There was really no do-overs, no clawbacks. There was no, not a single thread of connectivity between Covalent and its investors and this new company, Hyperic, which was called Hyperic because all good names are taken, and we came up with that one. Actually, it was originally called Hyperica, and one of the five co-founders, as he typed the application for the state of California, supposedly forgot to include the A, and so Hyperic was born, and we bootstrapped this company over the course of really almost 2 years. At the time, in 2004, the sort of nuclear winter of the post-dot-com era was ending, but we were coming into that as the byproduct of a clearly overcapitalized company that had been backed by some of the top investors. So there was basically no way that we could have raised money for this thing. And end up deciding through a lot of intuition and a lot of hard work, and really the guiding principle for Hyperic, certainly in its early days, was the absence of capital, the absence of money, led us to make some of the best decisions we made. We turned this very complicated product into something that anyone who can install Microsoft Word can install. And a product that could be deployed in less than 30 minutes, no matter where you were. That, for the 12 plus years that that product was actively being sold, remained one of its core distinctive, you know, competitive advantages. And that was born from the fact that we literally had no choice but to make it that way because we had no money to fly over to meet people and teach them how to deploy it. It needed to be obvious. And so many of the things about it, the go-to-market model, everything about it was really forged during an era where we had no investment. We're lucky enough later on to get investment from two amazing firms who saw the opportunity, were just completely infatuated with this idea that we had picked something out of the Sequoia trash heap and actually turned it into a company that actually delivered, even as a bootstrap firm, about $1.3 million in bookings in, you know, 18 months after we started, which was, it didn't feel like we had $1.2 million in anything, because we literally went from like, okay, $5 come in, one for you, one for you, one for you. Into building this company. It later gets VC funding from two of the best VC firms in the country. We had no idea. I personally, when I went to Excel Partners to pitch for our Series A and did the final partner meeting, I literally was so tired of pitching venture capitalists that as I sat and drank what turned out to be a very strong cup of coffee outside the firm, the firm's offices in Palo Alto, I got myself worked up into a frenzy, and I'm like, these guys, I know how this is gonna go down. I'm gonna go in there, and there's gonna be like 12 people, and they're gonna ask the same stupid questions, and it's gonna be the same song and dance, and I'm just so tired. At the time, we had an offer to sell the company to MySQL, which I was inclined to take. I'm like, I'm gonna sell this company. I don't give a shit what happens in there, whatever. I walk in there, and apparently delivered a command performance. I really acted like an obnoxious asshole, and I get, who knew VCs are really into that, right? Like, so pro tip for any of you looking to raise money in Sand Hill Road: definitely be an obnoxious asshole. That'll work great. I was convinced that I blew it. I walked out of the meeting, and people were like, you know, my co-founders who were there. I'm like, you guys, I'm sorry, but I'm just done with this. We're gonna sell the company. And they're like, huh, what happened in there? I'm like, you know, I'm tired of this. They're like, dude, you were awesome. I'm like, really awesome? Sure enough, literally an hour later, I get a phone call from Peter Fenton saying, hey, wow, the entire Jim Schwartz, like all these people were blown away. We wanna invest, who knows? We go build this company out. With two rounds of venture funding from Excel and Benchmark, I go from being, as my wife would lovingly describe it, you and four of your friends. So you're not CEO, you're CEO of you and four of your friends. It's, please get over yourself. To, this is a great thing about spouses, they really keep you grounded, especially this one. And I'm now a real CEO. I'm running a company that has thousands of customers. I have a management team, a board of directors, all these things. And, you know, things were looking really good. 2007, the company was growing. We were at a roughly $8 million a year run rate. Just a real amazing thing. And then this happened. Anybody seen this slide before? Anybody know what this is? This is the famous Sequoia Capital slaughtered pig presentation. It was a presentation that was done, it's probably the finest piece of PowerPoint hawkery that has ever been made in all of mankind. A presentation made by Sequoia that was distributed broadly to all its portfolio CEOs in the fall of 2008 in the wake of the Lehman Brothers collapse. Basically sending a very, that takes work, finding that on Google Images. A really strong signal that says, batten down the hatches, we're headed for an absolute disaster, blah, 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 and had all these amazing predictions, actually, that I pulled it up the other day when I was looking for this. It was awesome how mobile is not immune is one of the slides. I think it's like slide 8, suggesting stupidly that mobile is going to get also beaten down and that don't bet on mobile. It was just, it's amazing. You should look it up. But anyway, I sail into this as the, you know, first-time CEO of a now much larger company, and the entire world financial system is collapsing, and, you know, just to describe it as uncertainty is to not do it justice. It was a really, really amazing time. Coincidentally, a great time to get married. I got married in early October of that year. And through a really broad set of, you know, twists and turns, we managed to, as a small company, decide to merge with another portfolio company of ours, a friend. And we were super, super lucky to very quickly combine forces with another company that literally 90 days after we did that was acquired by VMware for $420 million. And so out of what was surely the darkest period of my professional career, I finally, almost 10 years to the day that I had even gotten into the business of startups, get to the finish line. That sort of, yeah, we sold the company. Everyone got paid, made lots of money. It's great. And so it was very, very strange, frankly, that in 2009, we when everything else was still sort of falling apart, that we get to this incredible outcome and begin what turned out to be a very interesting journey for me as part of being at VMware. And while I was there at VMware, it turned out, again, with the coincidences, that the CEO of VMware at the time, a gentleman named Paul Moritz, wonderful guy, who made the decision to acquire SpringSource and Hyperic, he was the one who had said that Netscape needed to be starved of oxygen and had signed sort of the death sentence on my sort of post-college dream. So the fact that I was able to go to Paul and say, hey, Paul, thank you for buying this company. By the way, my first job out of school was at Netscape, which you totally put out of business, WTF. Like, I'm glad. Karmically, no one's keeping score. We're just trying to really just make sense of all of this. It was just a really strange turn of events, but it gets, trust me, a lot stranger. So a little bit after that, I spent some time at VMware and really tune in personally to the fact that I was very bored with infrastructure software and IT-related matters. I was tired of selling stuff to IT departments and dealing with cranky IT people. They're nice, but they get cranky, and they're very busy, and they have lots and lots of vendors coming to hawk stuff and sell them, you know, dreams and stuff. And I get the opportunity to leave VMware after doing a 3.5-year stint there and go to a venture firm to be a entrepreneur in residence, which is like the non-jobbiest job ever. People were like, oh, man, congratulations on your new job. You're a VC? No, not a VC. Well, what are you? I don't really know. I go there and I hang out, I guess. I see stuff. Are you a partner? No. Do you write checks? No. I'm just there. And it was a great experience because I got to wash off a lot of cynicism that I had built up while at VMware about this business, and I got to tune into what I enjoy about being in small companies and startups, which is hearing extraordinarily passionate and often irrational people talk about these amazing products they want to build and these business opportunities they want to chase. And so during that time, I have multiple ideas. They all turned out to suck. I developed, you know, or I guess inherited the Javier's theory on products. There's three kinds of products. There's vitamins, painkillers, and Viagra. Vitamin products should be avoided at all costs. They're products that have benefits that are sort of only seen long after you've used them for a long time. They're sort of good for the soul, but not much else. Painkiller products are good, but they're fleeting, right? Like their utility is not something you can count on because, well, you're either subject to the person's tolerance of pain or the possibility that pain would just simply go away and they no longer need your products. Now, Viagra products, those are products that enable you to do things that you previously thought were not possible. And we should all be building those. But basically, it was you know, funny classification system aside, it was a good way to really, as my next act, and as a person who doesn't keep a little notebook of great ideas to build companies around, how do you have a heuristic so that you can really judge and test a hypothesis before you commit to it? And so this idea that there's all kinds of products and good ideas, but they don't really meet the bar of like really unlocking something that people certainly couldn't do before. And so we get to email, which, email? That was a very odd transition. It felt odd at the time, but we come up with, on a sheer coincidence again, a conversation in the hallway at Redpoint about email and about its lack of growth and utility on mobile phones. And out of that came this extraordinary idea to go and build a different kind of email product. And for me, aside from the actual product, it represented a very strong choice to not do what I knew how to do before, which was build infrastructure products for IT, and instead say, look, I am a career plumber. I don't know anything about making interior design choices. I'm not a good judge of aesthetics. I've never built a product that individual people, like all of you, would voluntarily choose because it is awesome. And that is a pretty daunting challenge, right? And so that self-awareness and that acknowledgement that that wasn't in my core set of skills is probably the thing that helped us the most throughout the Accompli journey. How does this relate, Javier, to Hoda and Kathy Lee Gifford, America's favorite day drinkers? Well, as you can see there at the bottom, in January of this year, after we had already sold the company to Microsoft, but before the product was renamed Outlook Mobile, one of our employees from Accompli, who I guess watches the Today Show, the later part of the Today Show, sent this screenshot to everybody in the company and said, holy shit, we're on the Today Show. And I would have never imagined, like there's no better image to capture what you're after as a consumer product than to be endorsed without asking for it by, I believe the gentleman's name is Gadget Gary, and Hoda and Kathy Lee as you know, app for the new year, and they talked about how awesome it was, and they talked about Focused Inbox. It was just incredible, and it was the bookend for the Accompli journey, which was short-lived. It was 18 months. To have accomplished this, for the better part of those 18 months, certainly before we announced the acquisition by Microsoft, so many people told me, Javier, you don't know how to do this. You don't know how to build apps. You don't know how to build a team that, look, we get it. You're a successful entrepreneur. You're very good at building companies, but this isn't your bag, dude. You're more like an infrastructure, enterprise-y kind of guy, and here you're talking about wanting to build an email app and a otherwise sort of consumer-facing product. It's not what you do. I guess we did it right. So, on to today. Summer of last year, after we had very successfully launched Accompli, in as much as a startup that announces a product can get coverage in the right places and get, you know, some amount of usage and notoriety, we were approached by Microsoft and their interest in partnering with us. Specifically, I'm approached by a gentleman named Chi Lu, also a graduate of Carnegie Mellon. He did his PhD here. He is now executive vice president, an all-around awesome guy at Microsoft for the application services group. So Chi and I got to know each other, and we started a conversation that ultimately led to Microsoft making an unsolicited bid to acquire Acompli at a time when we had no interest in selling the company and had really no reason to, other than this opportunity that we all saw to get there faster, right? If what winning meant, and we had this conversation, actually one of the defining traits of the Acompli team is that the majority of what we talk about is what does success mean for us right now? We're here to win, and what does winning actually mean? And the definition of winning can change over time, but if you can't answer that very clearly, you're not likely to be very successful. So our definition of winning was obviously mass usage of the product, and you know, this idea that we had made a dent in making email a better experience on the hundreds of millions of iPhone and Android devices that are out there. And we came to the conclusion that the opportunity to do that in partnership with Microsoft would be worth doing and would be its own set of challenges, and so indeed it was. We brought this team of 25 people into Microsoft in November, and a product that had, at the time, you know, I think 100,000, give or take, users. You know, and it had been around for 6 months, so that's pretty good for anybody who's tried to build an app. I mean, growth is very hard. The App Store is an unforgiving place. And, you know, in this setting now, we have tens of millions of users just a year later, right? So the satisfaction of looking back on this and saying, man, we were right. It was the right product. We identified what was wrong with mobile email. We had a very clear sense for how to solve it. We stayed very close to what our users were telling us. We built a very small and nimble but extraordinarily talented team. Unlike Hyperic, which felt very much like it was me and then a whole ton of other people sort of sitting on top of me, you know, looking for guidance on all matters from me. Like, I was very emotionally and sort of mechanically intertwined with everything that was Hyperic. This was, for the first time in my career, a genuine team effort where my co-founders were amazing and did their part in a way that no one else could. My leadership team, the employees, all 25 people that we had were just unbelievably awesome and marching in just such precision that in March of this year, I have this incredible opportunity to meet. I get this email, and it says, Bill Gates would like to meet with you. And I'm like, holy shit. That's pretty cool. And the list of sort of trophy moments for me, that one's definitely up there, right? And again, back with the Netscape thing, I'm like, this is just, I don't even know where to begin here. But you get to have this opportunity to sit one-on-one with Bill Gates. I'm sitting there trying to be all cool. Most of my discussion prior to the meeting was about whether it would be okay for me to take some kind of selfie or some other way of actually documenting that the event took place. Nah, it was not the right time for that. It was all too normal, frankly. He's a super nice guy. I mean, people at Microsoft are deeply intimidated for all the right reasons. He's a very intense dude, but it turns out with me, he was super cool. And so we get to this meeting, and he's asking me to tell him kind of the story. And he begins with, So when did you start this? And I'm like, well, we started in April of 2013. And he's like, and we bought you guys when? I'm like, November of last year. He's like, so 18 months, huh? And what he's really saying here is 18 months, how many people? I'm like, we're about 20 at the time of acquisition. 20 people, 18 months, did what hundreds of people, most of whom now work for me, which is a little weird, weren't able to do. For understandable reasons and reasons of Jeffrey Moore and chasm crossing and whatever other academic theory you want to apply to this. But to get to explain that to him and then realize that you have this unique opportunity to not only deliver this great product to Microsoft, which is of course now called Outlook and which all of you should use because it's awesome, but to also come into this company, this storied company with whom I have such a complex relationship with, in part because they sort of shattered my post-college dream, and be there in some ways to help redeem it, right? Like be part of this new leadership team and this new sense of direction. It's just an amazing, amazing experience. And throughout all of that, trying to not be too sort of rearward looking, but in a sense to try to answer this question that I started this talk with, which is, wow, it really seems like I just plotted this thing out, you know, perfectly. Well, it turns out, when I was growing up in Puerto Rico, I was blessed with the opportunity to have a stepfather who was very into the arts, particularly calligraphy. He passed away when I was 15 years old, but he was an amazing person in my life. And the house that we lived in, the house my mom still lives in, has a piece of calligraphy that he did that has a verse from a poem by a Latin American poet named Antonio Machado. And the, in Spanish, although it may not ring to you, is it says, "Caminante no hay camino, se hace camino al andar." This thing is literally, when you open the door to my mom's house, poof, there it is. And it's beautiful, and it's something very special. The message in English says, traveler, the road is made while walking, right? And so throughout all of this, you end up realizing if there's one thing I can leave you all with is the idea that you may think at this stage in your life that you have the opportunity to calculate every move that you want to make. You leave here very determined. You think you're getting this amazing education, which of course you are. And then you have this sense of drive and purpose that got you through your time at CMU, and you're going to translate that to go and pursue a career in whatever it is, right? And that there's some set path that you must follow. And the reality is, as I've learned, and I'm sure other people have too, that the road is really made while you walk, and that if you're lucky, you can sort of look back and say, man, that actually played out okay, even while many of those junctures seemingly didn't taste very nice or whatever. So with that, thank you very much for the opportunity to come here and talk to you all, and questions, I guess, if we have them, I don't know. Go ahead. Skip class, I did, many times. Sorry, wait, I gotta get closer. Here.
We'll give him the mic.
Yeah.
Check. What was your answer to Bill Gates? Why were you guys able to do in 18 months what it took, what hundreds of people at Microsoft previously couldn't do in years?
So good question. You know, he didn't ask me why. I knew he was thinking about it. He probably knew the answer himself. So the question was, you know, how do you explain that, you know, 20 people in 18 months can do what hundreds didn't do in years, right? A lot of it is rooted in the magic of startups is the done right ability to focus in the face of potentially insurmountable odds. We didn't have the luxury. If we failed, we were out of business. And so the way we looked at every important question was through that lens of like, failure means this party is over. Whereas at Microsoft or really any established company, that isn't true. And the absence of that kind of consequence when you're doing product development, it's probably the single most magical ingredient you could have. And it doesn't mean that big established companies can't build great products, but it means that it's harder because the failure of those products does not, at least immediately with it, drag down the entire, you know, company. I also think that there's some cultural aspects specifically of Microsoft that contributed to that being, you know, we are an extraordinarily talented and very smart bunch of people, and we mistake complexity with sophistication, right? So because our roots are in sort of these deep tech, we make holographic goggles for crying out loud. Like that's some serious stuff, right? Like I've tried them on, they're awesome. There's an art, I guess, to tackling problems that are still very complicated, but applying a very steady hand and very subtle and ideally minimalist approach to them. And that's something that isn't sort of an intrinsically baked-in thing at Microsoft, and it's something every company struggles with. I'd like to say Apple doesn't, but they do too, and you know, get there. Great question. Other questions? Mm-hmm. Yeah, the honest answer is I'm figuring that out as I go, because I am not a creature of those worlds. Like, the largest company that I had worked at prior to that was VMware, which was 1/10 the size of Microsoft, and then prior to that was Netscape, which was, you know, 5,000 people at its height or whatever. So what I've tried to do, particularly with the product management teams, is you just observe how people work, and you realize that there's an extraordinary amount of jargon and complexity, and sort of the content is very dense. The joke I have is we make building Outlook seem like we're building the space shuttle, which it's not. And then of course somebody tells me that they actually used Outlook on the space shuttle, and it gets really, and it's true, they do use Outlook, or they used Outlook on the space shuttle, and there's specific code in our transport libraries to deal with the latency involved. And well, anyway, the point is, you start sort of trying to instill a different set of values in people, and you start changing the way they communicate with each other, is my first approach. So we'd have these component reviews and these very sort of sophisticated pageants and parades, where now me as the corporate vice president gets, you know, the joy of having 2 days of people just killing me with PowerPoint and slides. I'm like, okay, this sucks. Can we not do this? And people are like, no, but the component review is like the most important thing. I'm like, you mean to tell me that every quarter I have to sit through this? This is terrible. This means that we are not able to stay aligned without these very sort of resource intensive moments where it all comes together and people spend weeks preparing for them. This, we will never, if we really internalize the position we are as kind of a challenger in this market, we cannot roll this way, because we're going to keep losing. So I did something different, which is I started by saying this team, these hundreds of people, the thousands of people that build Outlook and Office 365, need a common sense of purpose, which they did not have. Previously, a common sense of, the sense of purpose each team had was, well, make Outlook desktop great. Or actually, it was more nuanced than that. Make the, you know, triage or the deleting and archiving of emails in Outlook great. I'm like, dude, if you can't do that, that's like basic. You don't get you don't get an attaboy for that, right? We need a something that everybody rallies for. There is that mountain. We climb it. It's hard. It's steep. But if we get up there, there is gold up there, or whatever it is that motivates you. We, you know, some sense of challenge and a definition of winning. And so I was able to put together a strategy document and a way of framing this that was very simple. And along the way, explained to the people that just the way we talked was really contributing to us not building better products. I told everybody that to never bring me a list that had more than 3 items on it. Like, we had these project plans, and we're like, oh, in fiscal 2017, we'll be working. I'm like, fiscal 2017, the best I could tell you is that I hope to be alive, hopefully a little thinner. Maybe I'll be sleeping better, because my daughter will be a little older. But really, I can't tell you much more than maybe the fact that more people will use our product, right? Let's not talk about fiscal 17. Really, let's not talk. You have to earn the right to have a conversation with me that is more than 90 days out. And if you bring me a list of items that is longer than 3 items, I will assume that items 4 through 10 are lies. And they were, I did this in a room much like this, maybe a little bigger, with all the, it's like a big Outlook all hands. And they were like, lies. I'm like, yes, they're lies. You're not going to do half the shit that's on that slide. If you're lucky, you're going to get the first 2, right? Maybe the 3rd. So changing how people work, how they communicate, it's really hard. And as a single person in a company of hundreds of thousands of people with products that have been very are very successful. You can't go in there and sort of swinging your lightsaber around and sort of declaring yourself to be smarter than everybody else. That's not true, and it's not a fair way of. I just choose to be very honest, and I, you know, in reviews, like, tell people, I'm like, I'm sorry, but that sucks. We're not going to ship that. No, but we've done all this work. I'm sorry, that sucks. We're not shipping it. Wow, but ship it. It's okay. No, we don't ship crappy stuff. It sucks. No. I hopefully my email still works, so I haven't been fired. So we'll see how that goes. Another question. Yes, Dave. That is a good question. So thank you for asking that. When I left VMware, even while I was at VMware, there was this conversation that I would be subject to by a lot of people who would ask, well, what's your next thing? Surely you have another one of these things in, you know, planned out. Like, what are you going to do next? And I honestly had no idea. I had just come off of this extraordinarily dramatic thing, which I didn't do justice to, by the way, in terms of how I told the story. I was really trying to stay somewhat on time. But the experience of Hyperic was really emotional and very challenging. And the circumstances that led to the founding, I became an entrepreneur not because I had this idea and all this other stuff. No, I worked at a company where I helped build a product I really cared about. The company went out of business and I was stubborn, is sort of the way that my route into this game, right? The second time around with Accompli, yes, I did have an idea, but it took a lot of time and crafting to even come up with the idea that was worth it. And at the time, I started trying to write more. So one piece of advice, I guess, write more is good. Like writing, blogging, whatever. Even if nobody else reads it, getting into the habit of sort of getting better at expressing your opinions and your worldview is actually a very important skill to have. And I love small companies more than I love big companies. I love the technology industry. I'm walking and I'm sort of on a road now. I'm really trying to land this in a super poetic way. The honest to God answer is I don't know and I don't presume to know, and we'll see how this plays out. And you know, I've had this conversation with my wife about whether I would do this again. I still have it in me. I love being a CEO. It's a very, very unique job. It's a very lonely job. In many ways, a very shitty job. It's not for everybody. But I know for sure, I can tell you this much, I don't want Satya Nadella's job. I don't want to be CEO of Microsoft, ever. I look at that guy and I'm like, sucks. That is a world of hurt. There is no thing you could do. You're going to always be pissing somebody off, right? Like, there's somebody who's going to be disappointed with you at all times. I feel it now, and I'm not in charge, right? So we'll see. At a minimum, I hope to continue to be involved in helping people do this, even if I'm not doing it myself. One more, maybe? Yeah, go ahead.
Was there a time in your life where you felt you were in full charge of your life, for your own life?
You know what? Great question. Right as I was leaving here, I thought that was the case. When I was graduating from Carnegie Mellon, not when I was, there's leaving and then there's being left. So I was left from here in 1993, and I actually left with a diploma that I still look at just to confirm that it's still there. So at that point, I did feel like I had it all figured out, and I had everything under control, and I had a plan, even as that plan became to come out and work at Netscape. I thought I had this whole, I was very certain about things. Over time, I think the Hyperic experience, or maybe even Backflip. So the first startup was, I think, the first dose of, right, you think all it takes is being passionate and working hard? No, it actually takes good ideas. It takes a lot of other things, right? We all worked tirelessly. We were so famous at Backflip for how hard we worked. We were on ABC News because we were working on Thanksgiving Day. That ended up adding up to nothing, right? Like, other than having been on TV for all the wrong reasons, right? Like, so in a sense, it's getting comfortable with uncertainty and sort of really, enjoying the ride, and yes, acting with conviction is important, but thinking that you have some kind of master plan. Life just has this amazing way of really just messing with you, and it certainly did with me, and it was all great, and it worked out, but great way to end it. Thank you for the question. Thank you, everybody.